to have with us today Dr. R. R. Navalgund, former Director, Space Application Center and National Remote Sensing Agency, Department of Space. Sir has provided leadership in evolving and executing national level remote sensing applications program in the fields of crop production forecasting, watershed development, groundwater prospect, ocean color, coastal management, and district level planning. Sir has been a constant guiding force in defining the path of India's remote sensing satellite program. May I request you, sir, to please share your thoughts on remote sensing applications with IRS-1C and its future perspectives.
Am I audible? Thank you. Thank you for that kind introduction. Dr. Kasturangan, Dr. George Joseph, Chairman ISRO, D.K. Das, Director, Space Application Center, Shantanu Chowdhury, Director, National Remote Sensing Center, all distinguished speakers who have spoken before me, as well as those who are going to speak after this, my brief talk, as well as friends and colleagues who have been participating in this online function. A very good afternoon to each and everyone. It's a great pleasure for me to participate in this event. IRS-1C, in many ways, was a game changer. Nearly tested, I speak on IRS-1C applications and future perspectives in the background of celebrations of IRS-1C since its launch 25 years ago on this very day. In such functions, it is somewhat advantageous to be the last speaker or the last but one speaker, because whatever needs to be said has already been said by the earlier stalwarts. But for the sake of completion, I would like to make a few remarks briefly on the IRS-1C and also perhaps tell you a few anecdotes of this IRS-1C. I think it would be more meaningful to talk about what value addition data from IRS-1C provided to overall applications than IRS-1C applications per se. Because remote sensing applications and their data requirements were very well known since the late 70s and the early 80s. Because we had the joint experiments program, we had the end-to-end experiments which ultimately culminated in the establishment of National Natural Resources Management System. We have also had the IRS utilization program very well defined. In addition, there were a large number of major national level application programs related to national crop production forecasting, integrated mission for sustainable development on watershed basis, wasteland mapping, coastal zone regulation. Many of these applications were already there in the offering, being executed with the data which is available from our own satellites to some extent and also internationally. While IRS-1A and 1B followed known base broad specifications existing for remote sensing satellites at that time, like Landsat, IRS-1C was to a large extent more tailored to meet specifically some of the needs of the Indian scenario. In that sense, IRS-1C is a unique system. Inclusion of shortwave infrared band to quantify moisture stress in vegetation and to facilitate better snow cloud discrimination were two important value additions in List 3. It was also configured to have 23-meter resolution vis-a-vis 36-meter, which was existing in the earlier List 2. This meant field parcels half the size than earlier could be detected, since the pixel area came down by half. So crop area estimation improved considerably. One could also quantify reduction in crop yield through some vegetation index involving shortwave infrared data and also drought assessment. However, snow cloud discrimination did not do so well. Of course, that is because the gain settings and the saturation radiances were set more specific to crops. Of course, the blame for this was mine, since I was the chair for setting up this saturation radiances and gain settings, because we were more interested in the agricultural applications. We also lost the blue band data because of shortwave infrared band had to be accommodated in the overall structural configuration of the payload itself. This, of course, prevented some of the applications related to estimating turbidity in coastal waters as well as in lakes. Now, frequent revisits is a major requirement in case of dynamic phenomena, including crop estimations. The WIFS wide field sensor, which was providing 5-day repeat revisit as well as 2-band, having 188-ton resolution, was very useful for estimating total cropped area, not necessarily individual crops, unless those crops were grown in very large homogeneous area. Of course, this was a much better proposition than the data which was available to us from NOAA of 1 kilometer. In this regard, I remember an interesting anecdote. Dr. Kasturirangan and Dr. George Joseph had taken me along to a meeting with Professor U.R. Rao, the then chairman, ISRO, for taking a final decision on the inclusion of shortwave infrared band in list 3. You know, getting shortwave infrared detectors was an expensive proposition. We were not happy. The people from the applications area were not very happy that shortwave infrared is only included in the list 3, but not in wide field sensor. I also was not happy that the wide field sensor had a very coarse resolution of 188 meters. So in this meeting, which was we were to meet Professor U.R. Rao, I wanted to tell Professor Rao, mustering enough courage, that it must be included in WIFS shortwave infrared band, as well as resolution must be made more adequate. But both Dr. George Joseph and Dr. Kasturirangan prevailed upon me not to express my view to Professor U.R. Rao there in the meeting. And maybe they were a little apprehensive. After hearing this, Professor Rao might say, then let's not have WIFS at all in IRS-1C. So anyway, I must admit, but this idea of having a very wide field sensor finally got realized in IRSP-6, that is ResourceSat-1, in which we had the advanced wide field sensor. So in that we had 4 bands, including the shortwave infrared, and also we had the resolution from 188 meters to 56 meters. But Dr. George Joseph did not leave me. He said, you must do a large amount of simulation exercises to show why you require 50 to 60 meters with 5-day repeativity and not 188 meter, why it will not do just like that. So quantitatively, we had to estimate and make simulations to make sure that advanced wide field sensor could have these kind of specifications. Now, this was launched in 2003 while I was at the National Remote Sensing Agency. At that time, it was called National Remote Sensing Agency, not the National Remote Sensing Center as it is known today. But most of you know this advanced wide field sensor became extremely useful, popular, and I must also add that it became a workhorse sensor for even the United States Department of Agriculture for their world acreage estimation for different crops. I think inclusion of a relatively high resolution pan camera in IRS-1C was the most important contribution. As I have pointed out, there was only 10 meter panchromatic data available from spot at that time. Pan camera data allowed us to map urban sprawl and also make perspective plans. For the first time, a perspective plan for Ahmedabad Regional Development Authority 2012 was prepared at SAC sometime in 1996 itself. Chairman Ahmedabad Urban Development Authority came over to SAC to receive the report from Dr. George Joseph, the then director SAC, and very much appreciated the inputs. This had its own benefits in our interactions with the civic authorities at that time, who were forcing us to part with some of our land to expand the roads in front of our campus at Ahmedabad. I do fondly remember on this day, my colleague and friend, Dr. Subhan Khan Pathan, who was responsible for generating this perspective plan for AUDA. Tragically, a few years later, he died collapsing at the podium while addressing a symposium at Srinagar, University of Srinagar, talking about the perspective plans he had made for different cities, including Ahmedabad. For the first time, pan-sharpened list 3 products became available and helped in many large-scale applications like coastal zone, watershed, etc. Pan-sharpened list 3 images for the entire country will also be used in another very important project called GCP Library, that is the ground identification of ground control points at a reconnaissance level. As many point out, we are good in jugaads. This pan camera later morphs into the 3-band multispectral LIS 4 camera in IRSP 6. I must mention here, while introspecting, there were a few issues with data processing as well. There were odd even radiometric imbalance in one of the LIS bands, image ghosting in wide field sensor, and visibly disturbing striping in pan, all hindering the use of these sensor data for ultimate intended applications. The mosaicing of 3 pan strips separated in the along track direction brought a latitude dependent problem to resolve for data processing team. Each of these was first of its kind. I fondly recount excellent efforts made by the data processing team at the Space Application Center, led by Dr. K.L. Majumdar at that time, and facilitating better utilization. He may be there in the audience. Let me salute him for these great efforts as well. In some instances, in view of this problem, we had the average of 2 pixels resulting in 46 meter resolution instead of 23 meters. I must lightheartedly quote a comment made by a senior colleague of mine in the applications area. Sir, we have a LIS 2 camera, LIS 2 and a half camera instead of LIS 3. Dr. George Joseph was very gracious in accepting it and smiling away. Launch of IRS 1D, identical to 1C in many respects, within a couple of years, that was in 1997, helped in providing data at more frequent intervals, for some time providing enhanced applications. IRS 1C provided the right direction and ideas to configure future missions with multiple resolution sensor systems to meet the challenging needs of the stakeholders. As far as the future perspectives are concerned, I must mention a couple of years ago, Chairman ISRO, Dr. Shivan, had asked me to chair a meeting. I had the privilege of chairing meetings of a large number of users and stakeholders from all disciplines and sectors, both in Delhi as well as in Bangalore. Data required, sensors to be configured, and missions to be accomplished were very well defined. They include missions who are required for meeting the needs of operational applications, which are very important as far as India is concerned, notwithstanding the availability of international data from international missions. Then also address the needs of climate change, global change, greenhouse gases, and such many science missions, as well as many of the experimental missions which will enhance our technology and science efforts. So there is a gradation in the idea of these various missions. In addition to them, there is also a constellation of satellites, particularly as Chairman ISRO mentioned today afternoon about the disaster monitoring systems, constellation of satellites for disaster monitoring, particularly inclined orbits with synthetic aperture radar, which will give frequent repetitivity and will monitor the disaster events. All these are embedded in this particular report that we have. Now it is up to us, I mean ISRO and the integrated private sector, to accomplish some of these missions and fulfill the needs of the stakeholders and also be providers of data and products to international market as well. I must mention that today, as in the past, most of the users want cooked food in the sense they want ready-to-use products, models which can be plugged in along with all other relevant data so that you provide a solution to those things. So a large amount of efforts is required in all these efforts. I think stop at this stage by congratulating Nilesh, the President ISRS, and his team for taking initiative in organizing this event. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with